So we're going to be talking about site assessment for planting trees as well as planting. And a lot of things go into that if you're going to do it well. A lot of things go into that. Looking at how much space you actually have available for a tree. In terms of energy conservation, I think we need to think of trees in terms of longevity. What space do we have available? What soil do we have available? What conditions do we have available to create the best environment for that tree or that plant material to live a very long life? Most urban trees that we're used to being around have an average lifespan of 10 to 15 years. Obviously, we would like to give trees an opportunity to live out their lives and be looking at 75 to 100 years as best we can, reaching towards that instead of a shorter lifespan. So preparation before planting and even species selection really plays a huge role in that. Today is an exciting time to be planting plant material, in my opinion, because there are so many different cultivars, different species, different cultivars, different varieties. So there's a huge menu available to you to select from: containers, bare root, and bald and burlapped. So the menu is really wide open for you. It's really down to getting to looking at what space you have available and amending the soil properly for the species and your site. So here you see where we're standing. There's a very large mature oak behind me. This landscape that we're on is a wonderful example of a well thought out, well designed and implemented landscape. This oak behind me is probably about 60 feet off of the building. It was planted for shade, obviously, but it was planted also as a focal point of the landscape. But it was planted based on knowing what the mature size of this tree would be. I think one of the main benefits that we tend to think of in terms of mature trees is shade, and that certainly is a huge benefit of trees so far as energy conservation goes. You can look up some really cool, if you're a numbers, information-driven person, research that's been done on plantings that are on the west side of houses or buildings that really get into the number crunching of how much money you can save, the percentage that you can drop your electric bill from having planting material on the west side of your house that's going to block that afternoon sun. But there are other benefits, many other benefits, and I won't go into all of them, but one that I think we miss a lot is transpiration, which is the water coming up through the roots, being taken up into the trees, then out into the branches and out into the leaves. It serves a purpose, or two purposes, for the trees. It helps cool the tree and kind of regulate the temperature of the tree itself to keep it from stressing out. It also obviously carries the nutrients that are needed as part of the process of photosynthesis for the tree to create its own food. But for us, it's really interesting because through that process of transpiration, water vapor is released. That creates cooling in the environment around that plant material. So they're like air conditioners sitting around all outside, which to me is phenomenal. So try to start thinking outside of the box, if you don't already, about the benefits of plant material, both mature large trees like this oak appropriately planted, but also smaller plantings. Woody plant material, small plant trees, large shrubs are all a part of the energy conservation that you can reap the benefits of. So here we are getting ready to put in a planting in this established landscape. And as we just got through looking at the oak for appropriate placement, this tree is appropriate for placement here, even though we've got the hardscape in the background, because we know it's going to have a much smaller root system. It's not going to be in conflict with that. Some of the things that you would want to do before you got to this point would be to call your loco, or to have your utility lines marked, so you would know if you had any gas lines or your electric lines. Also, if you have irrigation in your landscape, those things like that you would want to have marked before you get into digging and have a mistake. Another thing to be very aware of when you're planting and you're thinking in terms, which hopefully we all would be, in terms of longevity, so that we can receive all of the energy conservation benefits that are available to us through especially maturing and mature plants, is to consider the environment that they're going to be growing in and to choose things that can be successful in that environment. If that environment does not already exist, then we try to create that environment. Here, we know that this soil, when this building was constructed several decades ago, that these beds were created with the intent of housing a successful soil environment. So good backfill was brought in. It's mulched regularly. We know we have irrigation here for this plant material. That's something else to think about. If you are limited with irrigation or with the type of soil that you have, which most of us are, quite frankly, in urban settings, then those are things that you need to think about before you start planting, and they are certainly things that you need to think about before you pick out your plant material. A simple way to see what kind of soil you've got is, if you don't, most homeowners probably would not have a soil probe like we have here, but you can use a shovel, which most people would have, or a trowel, and just start digging in and see what you've got. So I'm gonna put this soil probe in and we're gonna see what type of soil we're looking at here. And you can see it didn't meet much resistance going in, so that's a good indicator that there is not too much compaction. Soil moisture factors into that, and we have had rain here recently, so that's part of the ease of it going in. But two, it's good soil. You see the top several inches are that nice dark brown. That's partly from the soil that was brought in many years ago, but more than anything, that is likely a result of the mulch. This bed has been mulched for decades, literally. I mean, that's what we rob ourselves of in suburbia, is the natural mulch that nature provides on our deciduous trees. So in the forest, we get that nice organic breakdown happening. We shoot ourselves in the foot in our landscapes, often in suburbia. So that's our breakdown from the mulch and from leaf litter here, which is really nice. And then you see down here, I don't have anything that concerns me. I don't have, there's not the odor. With an anaerobic soil, you'll get a very strong odor of sulfur, smells like rotten eggs, and the soil will have a gray color to it, a bluish gray color to it. If you want to go the extra mile as a homeowner, you can take a soil sample and send it. You can contact your local extension service to see where you should send it. But you can send a soil sample in so you can find out what your pH actually is, and you'll find out lots of other information specific to the soil in the site that you would be working in. That too just builds the case for what species of tree you should pick and what amendments would be appropriate to make. Also, what fertilization would be appropriate or inappropriate to your planting area.